This clip is brought to you by SaveWithConrad.com.
I got to tell you, it is pretty interesting that the creative sort of is what it is. They're making Josh Matthews a heel. He's going to be trying to have a feud with Jeremy Borash.
Wait. Let me make something very clear. They weren't making Josh a heel.
Okay. He was a natural heel.
Okay.
And he can't help himself, but on commentary, and I'm sure this is all the plan, but you know, he's rebelling against, you know, Karen and Jeff Jarrett. And, you know, I mean, Jeff's not even appearing on screen at this point, but they are making it clear that Karen is married to Jeff, and he's going to make fun of the Jarretts bringing in guys like Bruce Prichard and Dutch Mantel. And he basically says the only reason the fans are even here at TNA is because they're too cheap to buy tickets to see NXT. I guess we're making an angle out of it's maybe an invasion. I don't know, but the idea that we're shitting our announcer is shitting on our fans, saying, oh, they're only here 'cause they're too cheap to buy tickets to the good show. What the fuck?
Well, I mean, we were going with reality television.
I don't know, man. It's just like, wait a minute. This is the plan. What is this now?
Yeah. I think that the idea was to look at what they had done in the past and yeah, and kind of go poo poo all over it and say, but what we're doing now is good. And that was kind of the idea about it. Don't ignore what, you know, don't ignore what's out there. Just embrace it and talk about it.
And the Observer, Meltzer, right? The first show from Mumbai was notable because the show itself, when you were watching it, looked like it was from the Impact Zone. The two studios are remarkably similar, and they didn't dress the studio up to look different. The crowd was more enthusiastic, partially because they were prompted to be, and because it was something new to them. I just think that's fascinating to me. He did put, the serious wrestling is good, and Bobby Lashley has been booked better as world champion than WWE champions. Still, there is way too much authority figure backstage stuff. The show had four different Bruce Prichard segments in what seemed like 45 minutes. I think Prichard is very good as far as he's a good talker, knows how to talk to a wrestling audience, but I'd rather have a more babyface authority figure just because the heel stuff is overdone, but I'd also rather they used it sparingly instead of almost the guy who is carrying the show. Also in 2017, the Rockstar Spud versus Swoggle thing just feels really out of place. Did you ever think, you know, and obviously you're your biggest fan, but did you ever think, dude, we got too many segments for me in this?
Oh God. Yes. Absolutely. But then again, you can never have too much of me.
Oh my God. Listen to you.
What?
Well, I just know that, you know, sometimes it's easier to see the forest for the trees, but you guys also probably feel like, well, we need to leverage the podcast audience. And if there's any chance this could get a little more traction, we'll find a way to do it.
I mean, no, it was, and especially on that trip in particular, was limited resources.
There's just less folks here. So somebody's got to do it. Might as well be you.
Right. And so it was,
that makes sense,
one of those that I had to be in damn near every scene, it felt like, to bring it forward.
Let's talk about this grand championship. We alluded to this earlier and we mentioned that there were judges. What'd you think of this concept that whenever the grand championship is defended, there's going to be judges at ringside? You did this a few times. Once it was you, Dutch, and Scott D'Amore. I don't know. It feels kind of weird, but kind of interesting, different. What'd you think?
Jeff, you know, I love you, man. But I thought it was stupidest fucking shit ever. They were trying things to do different. It sucked. It made no sense. And it was hard to follow. So, you know, especially when the fucking guys in the ring aren't doing their part. I'm like, there was one, God, I don't remember if we were live or what, but there was one. I said, you know what? Fuck it. I'm giving it to the other guy. That was fucking horrible. If he thinks that's getting over, he thinks that's what he was supposed to do to get over. Yeah, it was.
I feel like Jeff has a good sense of humor about it, though. Like, and again, I wasn't there and I don't know him like you do, but if you're out there and a segment is a real stinker and it was one that was his idea or he wrote, it feels like when he comes through the curtain, he would just say, boy, that fucking sucked, didn't it?
Pretty much. You have to.
Yeah, I mean,
you've got to know when you're out there whether they're buying this or not. And I've had more than 18. Or you just come back and go, that was fucking rotten. The judging thing to me was rotten.
Let's fast forward to the end of June. Meltzer would write, the company released agents Al Snow, Pat Kenny, and Shane Helms this past week, which is clearly budget cutting. Kenny, who's 49, has been with the company since 2003. Snow, who's 53, started at the end of 08. Helms, who's 42, started in 2015. They're going with Sanjay Dutt and Abyss as the agent, since they can double as wrestlers. Dutt is tight with Jarrett and is in charge of finding the top unsigned talent and rebuilding the X division, among other things. The fact they've had to start letting people go when they already have a skeleton crew to begin with is not a good sign for right now and Anthem's ability to grow the company. As far as the choices went, Jarrett is going to want his people in, and Helms is closely aligned with the Hardys, who aren't there anymore. There's also a ton of frustration with the reality that as long as they're on Pop TV, their numbers are pretty limited in what they can draw. But with the numbers they're getting and it being pro wrestling with its lack of appeal to advertisers, these numbers make it hard to get to a bigger outlet. Citing what you used to do with Spike got them Pop. But in the TV world, Spike is so many years back now, it's ancient history. You're friends with all these guys, Al Snow, Pat Kenny, and Shane Helms. Were you surprised, disappointed? What's your reaction to hear that they're gone?
Well, I was a little disappointed because they were my ride a lot of times. And I enjoyed being around. I thought they were good at what they did, but I also understood the cost cutting side of things and the reality that, you know, look, we did 6 shows in India with half the crew and didn't miss a beat in a lot of respects. So to make the argument that, oh, okay, we need more people, was kind of hard to do when you were only doing 2 shows a day. So that was, it just was cost cutting and it was time. So those things unfortunately happen and you got to roll with the punches.
The Al Snow Kenny thing really jumped out to me just because they had been there for so long. But it, you know, Jeff ultimately decides to keep Sanjay and Abyss around. Pretty interesting. They both wound up in WWE. It's a small world, is it not, Mr. Prichard?
It definitely is. Definitely is. You never say goodbye. You always say so long.
Hey, it's Conrad Thompson. Thanks for checking out the podcast here on YouTube. Be sure to hit the subscribe button and the notifications bell so you get a notice anytime we upload some new content. And go save yourself some money right now. If you're in a 30-year loan or you have credit card debt, it's not a matter of if I can save you money. It's a matter of how much. Find out right now for free at SaveWithConrad.com.